Lord, and my spirit rejoices in his name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, hold him captive. Hallelujah. Yeah. And so does magnify the Lord. Yeah.
is great.
He is great.
He is great.
He is great.
He is great.
Of Calvary for us. What would have happened if we did not come to you? Lord, if you did not pay the price, we don't know where we would have been. Thank you for the light that drove away the darkness in our lives. Blessed be your name. Today we can say we live because you live also. Hallelujah. To the Lord, sing hallelujah to the Lord, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, let us sing.
For me,
he went to the cross for me.
Christ went to Calvary.
paid all the price for me. Jesus paid all the price for me.
Father, we have come just to seek you. We've come today, Father, just to honor you. We want to say thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you've done. We will never forget, Jesus. Just as you say that our names are written on the palm of your hands, Lord, remember somebody here today. Let your blessings, let it overflow like never before. Let your hand go through, and that which you have done that has never been in vain, let the shed blood of Jesus be made manifest today in Jesus' name. And somebody said amen. And somebody said amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now I want to welcome us. If you're here at Grace for the first time, we want you to wave your hands. We're not going to embarrass you. Church, put your hands together for the Lord. And if you're watching us online, we're so delighted that you were able to join us. And can we take this together? You are welcome to GIC. You are welcome in the name of the Lord. Let's go, God.
You are welcome to GIC. You are welcome in the name of the Lord.
Church. you to turn to somebody, at least one person. Tell them, my brother, oh, my sister, you're blessed of the Lord. You're wonderfully made of our God. And I'm so delighted that you're sitting next to me. And tell them a good Grace International welcome. God bless you.
Come early to church. When you come early to church, you give yourself time to prepare physically, mentally, and spiritually to receive all that God has for you. Be faithful in the giving of your tithes and offerings, because God loves a cheerful giver.
Our service times are as follows. Every Sunday morning, we have service at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. On Wednesdays, we have Grace Clinic, which is our Bible study, and that takes place at 7 p.m. Every Friday is an hour of prayer, which takes place at 8 p.m., and which can also be attended on Zoom. And every Saturday is our youth service, which takes place at 6 p.m. here in the church sanctuary. We'd love to see you there.
Communion emblems are always available in our prayer room next to the visitors' room. Kindly endeavor to regularly partake with your family at church and at home. Healings and testimonies abound in our lives when we partake of communion often.
The grace of God, it's much more than just unmerited favor, though it is favor that is not merited. The power of God coming upon a man that's reflective on their life.
We know that our God loves us and delights in blessing us with good things. So we ask you to ask yourself, what good things has God done for me lately? Here at Grace, every first Sunday of the month is Testimony Sunday, is where we'd love to feature your testimony.
Hello, lovely lady. You are cordially invited to join our Vogue Women's Ministry. We meet every first Saturday of the month at 4 p.m. Times and locations are announced on our WhatsApp group. To be added to our WhatsApp group, please see any Vogue member or contact the church office and we'll add you to that group. Hope to see you there.
Join us this next session, Saturday, April 6th, for Raising Children of This Present Generation, Part 2. You don't want to miss this.
Grace International Church presents our men's ministry, The Men of Valor. Our purpose is to come together as brothers with the main aim of knowing more about God and developing the bond of brotherhood in love. We are committed to our individual and collective self-development, sharing our hearts and lives, praying for one another, and supporting each other according to the scriptures. If you desire to be in community and contribute to the kingdom of God, join us today and be a part of the Men of Valor. We look forward to having you.
Place where your child will grow and learn in a godly environment, please consider Grace Academy. We are open from 6 a.m. to 7 p.m. and have great rates. please call 281-564-7220 to schedule a tour today.
For more information and further details on all announcements, please refer to your bulletin.
So I'll cherish, and so I'll cherish the rugged cross. Yeah, till my trophies, hallelujah,
at last I lay them down.
Oh, I will cling, sing, I will cling to the
my trophies,
till at last I lay down. Oh, I will cling to the old rugged cross.
One day I'll exchange them, I'll wear my crown.
One day
I'll wear my crown.
One day. till my trophies at last I lay down.
Oh, I will cling,
I will cling to the
trophies at last I'll lay down. Oh, I will cling to the old rugged cross. Oh, and exchange it someday for a crown. Hallelujah. One day I'll exchange. Hallelujah.
Messiah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, we're alive and well this evening. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a round of applause for a phenomenal choir. However, we're going to take the tithes and offerings after the word and after the ministration. We'll do the tithes and offerings after the word and after the ministration. Amen. Are we blessed this evening? Give the Lord another big round of applause. It's already an Easter to remember. Praise the Lord. Pastor Aldon took me by shock. Amen. Were we blessed? Give the Lord a big hand. We thank God. This is the first evening of our Easter celebration service. And we thank God for what He's doing. I trust that we have come expectant to receive, not from man, but from God. The expectations of the righteous shall not be cut off. Jesus said in Matthew 9:29, it is unto us according to our faith. According to our faith. And many times our expectation is a measure of our faith. What are we expecting God to do? That's a decision, a conscious act of our will that we can walk on. In order for us to enhance our capacity to receive from God. Amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I think we can begin to read there from verse 23. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. From verse 23. And we will go down until... verse 30. We will teach from verse 23 and we'll go down to verse 30. Praise the Lord. Here, Apostle Paul begins to hand over, as it were, to us what was handed over to him to let us know that life is a relay race and God calls us and blesses us not primarily for us. If you're blessed by God, please understand you have a responsibility. You have a responsibility for what you've learned of God, what you've received of God, what you've been given by God, to be a blessing to somebody else too. Say amen, somebody. That's important for us to understand. Paul starts out by telling us this, for I have received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. Now, one of the mistakes we can make, that we do make, that we often make, is to confuse the postman with the post, with the letter writer. Praise the Lord. You know, the letter writer writes a letter or is delivering the package. He cannot get it down to you for different reasons. So he mails it, or he, you know, gets a delivery man to deliver the package. And so the postman brings it to you, and then you receive it, you take it, you're blessed by it. And then because the postman brought it to you, you now think that the letter is from the postman as opposed to the person who sent the postman. So that's a mistake we often make, that we ought not to be making. Paul makes that clear. Whatever you get from me, you get from me because he gave it to me. All I am is a postman. All I am is a delivery. All I'm doing, if God don't give me nothing, I can't deliver nothing. Everything I'm delivering unto you, I give to you because God gave to me. I received from that which also I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take it, this is my body. Notice he did not say this is symbolic of my body. He did not say this is an emblem of my body. He said, this is my body. So in other words, when we pray over, yes, they are symbols and they're emblems, but much more than that, they literally become the medium of the body and blood of the Lord when we pray over them, anointing them with our faith released to partake of them in the body and blood of the Lord. Praise the Lord. So they cease to be crackers and juice. No. It's the body and blood of the Lord. Take each. This is my body which is broken for you. Do it in remembrance of you. Let's read on. Do it in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often. Somebody say often. Let's say it again, often. Let's say it one more time, often. So we are supposed to do this often. And what a great time and an incredible evening for us to do this as we remember the night that Jesus was betrayed. All of the miracle of Easter started with the betrayal. So the next time you're betrayed, you ought to rejoice because you understand that it must be that God has an Easter miracle for you. Amen? Amen. Glory to God. You must remember and understand that your Savior, what you celebrate most about him, what you rejoice most about him, the most significant event about his life was commenced by betrayal. Betrayal is part of life. We all hate to be betrayed. It's one of the most painful things that can happen to us. But the reality is, oftentimes following betrayal is usually our greatest exaltations. We see it with Easter, with Jesus. We see it with Joseph, that his brothers betraying him was what set up a chain of events that catapulted him to be prime minister of Egypt. Praise the Lord. Joseph was the first Barack Obama. You understand? What was miracle? You see, sometimes we read stuff in the Bible, we don't understand how powerful it is. Egyptians hated Hebrews. Praise the Lord. Race did not just start in America between blacks and whites. No. We're racist people all the time. That's why the Bible said, when Pharaoh called for him, he shaved his beard. That's in your Bible. Because, you know, Jews, they were the beard identified them. It wasn't just a status thing. It wasn't just, oh, I'm keeping my beard because my wife likes my beard. No. It was for identification. It was symbolic. And Jews carried beard from that day up until this day. And Egyptians could not stand them. They could not stand their race. They could not stand their color. Could not stand their religion. They could not stand their looks. And Joseph was smart. So when Pharaoh called for him, he knew this beard had to go. He made himself presentable and acceptable to the audience that was beckoning for him. Praise the Lord. The rest, they say, is history. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? So for this whole Easter thing started with betrayal. So this is such a wonderful time as we remember what happened to the Lord and see ourselves in the Easter story and remember that the prescription, the prescription that was given is the prescription of this body and blood of the Lord at the worst minute The worst season of our God is communion. So he says, in the same manner he took the cup after supper, saying, this is a new covenant in my blood. This do it as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, in remembrance of me, in remembrance of me, in remembrance of me. Many times when we remember the Lord, much of our worries, our stress, our anxieties, our feelings of despair and hopelessness, it will extinguish, it will evaporate. Because if Jesus went through it and came out successfully, you will go through it and come out successfully too. You will, because the Spirit of Jesus is in you. What was in him that caused him to come out successfully, that empowered him to be victorious, then God is also in you. Scriptures teach that greater is he that is in us. The greater one lies in us. Praise the Lord. So we can see ourselves in his story. And as we see ourselves in his story, we must not despair. We must look at what he did. And know that the pathway to victory and salvation lies in doing what he did. Amen. So he says, do you often remember of me? So remind yourself of me. Remind yourself of me. Your story is not isolated, it's not divorced, it's not disjointed from mine. Amen. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. A powerful revelation. Proclaim. To proclaim means to preach. Literally means to announce. Or to declare, or to unveil, or to make manifest. When we preach, we don't preach. There's nothing we preach that's new. The person that said there's nothing new under the sun, they are right. There's really nothing new under the sun. It's only new to anyone who have not heard it before, or anyone who is ignorant of it. Praise the Lord. When we preach, we only announce or unveil what's already there. This is what he's telling us. That communion is what preaches, the partaking of communion in my life is what preaches or what announces, what unveils or what makes manifest the dying and death of the Lord. You proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. You proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. You proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Many times in life, what blesses us is not what we have, but what we know we have. No wonder Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Because it is not truth that makes free. It's the knowledge of truth. Juneteenth is called Juneteenth. Makes that very clear. The Emancipation Proclamation had already been signed. It was illegal to own slaves in the United States. But slavery was still very common. Why? Because what was law had not been made known. Especially here in Texas. People still own slaves and they were preying on people's ignorance. Until the whole Juneteenth story, that's how it all came about. Because it was not enough to illegalize it. It was important to make every soul know that this is illegal. You can't do this anymore. Praise the Lord. So this is what he's letting us know. That one of the powerful consequences of communion is that communion preaches that which is true. Proclaims that which is true. makes manifest, makes known, reveals, lets us walk in the reality of that, which is true. The death, the dying and the death, and the resurrection of our Lord. Amen, somebody. Let's read on. Praise the Lord. Therefore, whoever, somebody say whoever. Let's say it again, whoever. Let's say it one more time, whoever. This means that all of us are covered in this. None of us is exempted from this. Whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord, watch this, in an unworthy manner, will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. He did not say, like many religious people have said, that whoever is unworthy. Because if he said, whoever is unworthy, not a one of us, including this preacher, ought to go near that communion table. That's not what he said. What he said, thankfully, is whoever partakes of it in an unworthy manner. So it is the mannerism and the faith with which we take it that it speaks to and not us. Because in fact, it is because of what that communion table represents that made us all accepted in him. Say amen, somebody. That made all of us, regardless of who we were or where we came from, that made all of us now worthy before the Lord. Amen? So whoever, therefore whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Then he goes on to tell us how to immunize ourselves from partaking of it in an unworthy manner. Verse 28, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. The problem many times in the body of Christ is that we take examination on others. The teaching of Scripture is that examination ought to be self-directed. And others should be left to the Lord. God knows how to get other people. Hello, somebody. You must learn away as a lover of God. You must learn to get away from people who have taken on the ministry of criticism. And they feel like they've been anointed to be the policeman over the body of Christ. And they're looking for what everybody did wrong in order to slam us. No, slam yourself. Praise the Lord. That's what the scriptures teach. And many times you will see that people who do that, their own lives is sad. You wonder, how? Where did you have the time for me? With you being the way you are. Praise the Lord. And that's really not surprising because taking care of me is a full-time job. So if I'm really doing the way I should, I have no time for you. Hello, somebody. I have no time to examine you. I ought to be examining me. Let every man examine himself and so let him eat. Verse 29, but he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner, we see that again, eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Not discerning the Lord's body. That's the key right there. To discern his body. To consider what he came for, why he died, the purpose of his death. And as we partake of communion, we release our faith to receive what the Lord died for, so that what he died for can be made manifest in our lives. So as we consider why he died for three major reasons. He died to take away the consequence of sin in our lives so that we can spend eternity with God. To deal with the sin nature, not just the consequence, the nature. That thing that all of us got, were birthed with. David said, I was shaped in iniquity. I was conceived in sin. That made every single one of us to have some proclivity that we know is not right. Because it came in the nature that we received all the way traced to Adam. Praise the Lord. I'm always intrigued when I go to Africa, or Nigeria specifically. And, you know, if you ask people where they come from, they say where their parents come from. It never made sense to me. Because if I'm from where my parents come from, then they should be from where their parents come from. Then they should be from where their parents come from. Then all of us come from the Garden of Eden. You understand what I'm saying? So I never understood that thinking. Okay? Everybody who is somewhere, you know, landed there at some point. So if it has to be, you know, some people, where they claim as where they come, they've never been there. They can't speak the language. They don't know the culture. They know nothing. And yet they will, where do you come from? I'm from Delta State. I'm from Agbo. Have you ever been to Agbo? I don't even know where Agbo is. I've never understood it. Praise the Lord. So you know how I feel about that. I just feel that needs to be eradicated completely. Anyway. So all of us got our sin nature from Adam. The tendency, the proclivity to be dysfunctional in one area or the other. Jesus came to deal with that. Deal with the nature and deal with the consequence. So he came to deal with sin. So that the effect of sin, the sting of sin, can be eternally taken off in our lives. And we do not have to live conscious of sin anymore. Can understand that we are now right with God. Not because of what we did, but because of what Jesus did. That him who knew no sin took on himself our sin so that we can now become the righteousness of God, the Bible says. Jesus said, I never did anything wrong. But I am going to stand in your place. And you who did everything wrong, I am going to take the effect of what you did on me. And me who did everything right, I'm going to put what I did on you. Glory to God. Dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand. I am who I am, I'm where I am because of all that he did. Praise the Lord. He came to take away sickness. Yes, he did. The scriptures are not silent about that. He was wounded for our transgressions. Bruised for our infirmities. The chastisement for our sins was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. He demonstrated that in his earthly ministry. Going up, the scripture said, he went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Praise the Lord. And he came to take away poverty. Not having enough. It's more than just resources, but it's inclusive of resources. That Jesus came so that we can live life of more than enough. Praise the Lord. Now, that does not mean that even though we may be in not enough state now, that it means that we are ungodly. No, all of us, at one time or the other in our lives, were in not enough state. But that does mean that as we walk with him, and as we begin to learn our covenant rights, and as we begin to release our faith in him, we release him to do the miracle that he can do in our lives to transport us from not enough to more than enough. Amen? And that he can use us to be a blessing to others who do not at this time have enough. Praise the Lord. So when we discern the Lord's body, we think about all of that. I think about my life, and I think about what Jesus did. I think about my place in it, and I think about how partaking of this communion is literally a point of contact, releasing my faith to make manifest of all that Jesus did to be manifested in my life. Praise the Lord. That if it's the consequence of the nature of sin is dealt with, if it is sickness, it has been taken care of. If it is poverty, it has been taken care of. Praise the Lord. So as I do that, I'm discerning the Lord's body. I'm releasing my faith to receive the blessings of communion. Now watch this. In verse 30, he says, for this reason. What reason? The reason he's been talking about before, where people either don't take communion or they take communion in an unworthy manner. They take communion not discerning the Lord's body. He says, for this reason, many, he's talking about Christian people now, many are weak and many are sick and many sleep. That sleep there means to prematurely die. Now, why do Christians die young? Why do Christians are weak? Why do this is not the only reason, of course not. It's heretic to preach that or insinuate that. But Paul does tell us this is a reason. This is a reason. So when we read that, then we ought to know that communion is the antidote to that. As I partake of communion, I immunize myself from weakness, from sickness, from premature death. Premature death shall not be your portion in Jesus' name. You will live long and fulfill destiny and do the will of God in this land of the living in Jesus' name. You will fulfill what God has called you to do, and you will do it to the glory of his name. And God will take the glory in Jesus' name. Do we receive it this evening? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we bless this bread and bless this cup. As we partake of it tonight, we thank you that they are literally transposed from natural to spiritual emblems, and they are the medium of your body and your blood. We release our faith that the promise of Scripture is made evident in our lives, and the manifestation, the proclamation of the dying and death of the Lord with his resurrection is made evident. That the resolution, the answer to sin, to sickness and poverty, the resolution to it is received in our obedience in partaking of this bread and this cup. Let your name be glorified through it in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is my body broken for you.
Hallelujah. He took the bread. He said, this is my body broken for you. Eat it. Do it in remembrance of me. Let's eat. Then he took the cup. I want us to raise it above our head. I want us to see everything that, whether it's intimately or remotely related unto us, I want us to see it under the blood this morning, this evening. The scriptures declare that when the death angel comes, our protection over him will be the blood. When the death angel comes, not if he comes, when he comes, the death angel will attempt to visit every house. When he does, the defense you are going to have will not be your fame or fortune. It will not be your education or your good looks. No, no, no. The death angel has no regards for that. But the blood of Jesus that is put on the lintel of your post shall give protection to you and yours. Shall give protection to us and ours. So as we partake of it tonight, I want us and need us to see everything, remotely or intimately related to us, under the blood. That the blood gives us protection. That the blood gives us preservation. That the blood gives us victory. In Jesus' name, let's drink.
Here today to share a testimony, to give God all glory and praise. In 2019, that scripture, Isaiah 53:5, became really real for me. I was diagnosed with a very extremely rare of lymphoma just before COVID hit, and that news was devastating to me. After going and getting many opinions, I was recommended to have immunotherapy. So in December of 2019, I did 4 weeks of immunotherapy, had to deal with all side effects and all kinds of things. I was in remission for about 2 years, and the cancer came back again in 2022. Through it all, my anchor scripture that I held on to was Isaiah 53:5. And I told God, and I told the devil, you've picked the wrong person to be fighting and putting cancer on. When Jesus heals me, I will give him all praise and glory. You've picked the wrong woman. I got a fight in my spirit. I refused to meditate on illness. I decided I was going to meditate on the word of God and his promises. And I will say this body that God made is the temple of the Holy Spirit. It's not the temple for any disease. So I would go for my treatments. The second time it came back, I had to do 6 months of therapy. 6 months, every week, going in, getting treatments, getting injection, through it all, still working, through it all, taking communion, through it all, having friends and family pray for me. At the completion of that, the doctor now came, my oncologist said, well, you've completed your treatment, but we did some imaging. We're concerned you have a growth here. You have a growth in your thyroid. You have a growth in your nose. We think the cancer did not respond to all the treatment. I said, the devil is a liar. We'll see about that. I kept on in my prayer closet. I said, he wanted me to sign up for a more aggressive 6-course of therapy, of aggressive treatment. And I said, you know what? Give me time. Let me just pray and let me just talk to my Father. And to the glory of God, I went, I did every surgery they told me to do, I did it. Got biopsy of this, got nasal surgery, got thyroid biopsy, got skin biopsy. Every biopsy came back negative. Negative. The doctor said he didn't even understand. The so-called growth that he said was a cancer, when they came back to test it, it wasn't even detectable as a cancer again. He said he can't explain it. I said, I can explain it. The King of Kings and the Lord of Glory, who's my Father, he healed me. And I want to encourage my brothers and sisters. Yes, sometimes God will heal you miraculously without any medication. Sometimes God would say, yes, walk in faith, do the treatment. I chose to walk in faith and do my treatments. And I trust and I thank God along the way. So I want to encourage you, no matter what you face, no matter what news a doctor may bring you, remember, the great physician is available. Remember, healing is the children's bread. And I want to encourage all of you tonight who may be facing a diagnosis or a worry or a health condition. God is alive and his word is a living, true world. You have the word of God that is his testimonies, his will and testament to you. If you don't even know what your word says, if you don't know what your will and testament says about plugging in and accepting his word, it won't work for you. What you know works for you. The spirit of a man sustains a man. If your spirit is fixed on the word of God and his promises, God will do it for you, because he's not a respecter of persons. He's a respecter of his word. Amen? So now I'm going to call Pastor Alice. We're going to have prayer for those seeking healing tonight.
Praise the Lord. I dare to say that from 2019, when we stood with her, women's convention after women's convention, the devil's a bad devil. It was October. The next year when the second diagnosis came, it was again October women's convention. And then I said to her, aha, I think the devil's mad. Because God's doing something great with your life. Last year when we went for the convention, we had heard that terrible news. And we said, we're going. We're going on a retreat. And I heard testimonies of ladies talk about how Minister Essie was doing this and doing that. Dignus Rose knows what I'm talking about. And it was literally unbelievable that I missed it all. She directs the entire choir along with Minister Wally. Guess what? If God could do it with her, God will do it for you. I don't know what your situation is, but we are inviting you out. Pastor's going to give the call. If you are here today and you got a bad news concerning your health, concerning your finances, or you're facing a situation that looks impossible, that anointing is in this house. I know it. This evening at 6 p.m., coming up to this program, the Lord told me, don't eat anything for 72 hours, and I didn't. I know God is up to something. So if you're here in this house, I want to invite you. Stand to our feet. Let's stand to our feet. Everyone praying. Everyone praying. Pastor.
Praise the Lord. Minister Dr. Essie is a general and bariatric surgeon for almost 25 years. Because always a tendency when somebody comes and gives a testimony, there's always somebody there who's saying they don't know anything. You understand what I'm saying? She is one of the few, I think less than 5% black female surgeons in this nation. It's a profession that's populated by white men. You know, that God raised her and blessed her and used her. And she went through all the training, all the board certifications and all of this and that. And the enemy attacked. And then the Lord gave the victory. So she comes out to share her testimony, to let us know what God can do and what God will do. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The scripture the Lord gave me and what the Lord told me. James chapter 5 from verse 13. James chapter 5 from verse 13. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to verse 15. James, this is Isaiah. James chapter 5. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing psalms. Psalms is what the Bible calls praise. What, you know, what we call praise, praise and worship, and praise. The Bible calls it psalms. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray for him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick. The Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. I think that's a very clear instruction. And the Lord told me, he said, read the word to my people. Let them hear it. And ask for them to respond to it. He said the response in obedience and faith to what I've said is what's going to provoke the flow of my power. Because tonight, the elders are going to come out, just as the Bible said. The oil is going to be available, just as the Bible said. Anyone that's sick. And yes, I know many times sickness is more than just physical sickness. Maybe emotional sickness. We're going to come out, and as you come out, tell the elder what you want them to pray with you about. Is anyone sick among you? Let him call for the elder. The power of God will be provoked, not because of the elders, not because of the oil, not because the church is special, but because God spoke and we were obedient. The prayer of faith shall heal the sick. The prayer of faith will save the sick. The Lord will raise him up. And any sins that have been committed will be forgiven. So anyone that's here tonight with any kind of sickness, I want you to come out. Just come out to any of the elders. We want to pray with you. When you come, let them know. Let them know what you want to be prayed about. Pray it on. Thank you, Jesus. Just continue to pray. Say, is any suffering among you? Let him pray. Just continue to pray and trust God. Just continue to pray and trust the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Somebody in this house, and you've been dealing with an emotional turmoil. It is so much that sometimes the doubting voices that you're hearing telling you that you're not going to make it has literally drowned out. It literally scares you. I want to pray for those that have been going through any emotional stuff, anxiety, depression. you to come out. I believe the power of God is in this house to break every bond in the name of Jesus. That spirit of anxiety, we rebuke it in the name of Jesus.
I've always been you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. And Jesus, you're the center. Everything around you. Oh, Jesus.
Let's continue to pray and stay prayerful. Let's continue to pray and stay supple. The presence of God is here.
There is power mighty in the Lord.
Just lift up our hands and worship the Lord. Everybody, everywhere, just give Him praise. Thank Him. How good He is, how good He's been. He's a real God, He's a holy God, He's a prayer answering God. His ears are not too heavy that He cannot hear, His hands are not too short that He cannot save. When we call on Him, He hears. He not only hears, He answers, He responds. Begin to thank Him by faith tonight for all of the things that He's done. Folk that were ministered to, healings that were wrought. Praise the Lord. As we go into our different places, let's consult our physicians and in different places and ask them to check again. And testimonies will abound. As those testimonies abound, please come back to testify. Like we heard Minister Essie did tonight, come back and testify of what God did so we can celebrate Him together and all of our faiths can be encouraged as we see Him do greater things to the praise and glory of His name. Let's lift up our hands one more time and just say something sweet to the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Pastor, I'm going to ask, please, if you would give me a drum roll. drum roll and keep the drum roll. I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying that like a drum roll, the reverberation of the testimonies and the praises that shall arise in this house shall ring from city to city, town to town, nation to nation, generation to generation, in Jesus' name. And somebody said amen.
Can we just rejoice? Can we give us a celebratory song? I just thank God for the great things He's done. God has been so good to His people. Hallelujah. A celebration song, go, not a slow celebration song. There we go.
Hallelujah, oh. Hallelujah, eh. It's the sound of victory.
Come on, sing.
Hallelujah.
Opportunity we have to praise. The wise believer has to learn to be like David. It means I don't care what you think. I'm going to praise him with everything that he's blessed me with. Every breath that I have, every strength that I have, every energy that I have, I'm going to use it to praise God while I can. Because there are people that are believing God for the strength that I have. I'm going to use it for His glory. And as we do that, you know, when praises go up, blessings come down. His glory come down. His praises provokes His presence. His praises provokes His power. His praises provoke His peace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we praise Him a little bit more this evening? Just a little bit more. We'll be going up in a minute. Glory to God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
No, somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sorry, Pastor, you are going to give me test one more time. Remember that test? If you love the devil, stay quiet. All right, all right. We're alive. We're alive. Amen. Before it really turns into our party tonight, it's giving time. We're going to honor God with our gifts. Our gifts, our tithes, offering, our love gifts. Yes, just package them. And we're going to remember in the book of Luke chapter 6 and verse 38, that says, "Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over." In this season, we're celebrating one of the greatest gift ever. The gift of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God gave him to us. And is the reason why we are alive today, living. He said he came that men might have life and have more abundantly. And we are living that life today. And of that life that he has given to us, the blessings that we're flowing in and we're flourishing in, we're now giving back to him. So I want us to do it honoring him for that gift that he first gave us. Amen? So additional ways to give at Grace, apart from cash and checks, we have Zelle, Cash App, credit card, debit card, on our website, mobile app, many ways that we can give tonight. So I want us to connect with all and present our gifts to him. In Jesus' name. But I want us to rise as we take our confession together. Hallelujah. I feel like there's a rejoicing in the house still this evening. Let's go together. After four. Three, four. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you because I message is at heart. Your word declares that bringing my tithe, offering, and gift of love is a principal way by which I come into your blessing. In obedience to your word, I bring my tithe, offering, and gift of love. I thank you, Lord, for opening the windows of heaven and pouring your blessing on me and causing all grace to abound towards me, empowering me to be enriched in all walks of life. Men use their gifts, their talents, and their resources to help me succeed in life. This is your will for me, and I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. So we continue rejoicing as we give.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we bring your daughter, Nicholas Rose before you, and we ask that you strengthen and bless her, that she will continue to grow in grace and in strength in the name of Jesus, that your favor will be upon her and be upon her home and everything that concerns her in the name of Jesus. Only celebration will hear, constant and continuous celebration in the name of Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's put our hands together for Jesus. It's a great day. Amen. Amen. We're going to share the grace together in fellowship. Let's rise to our feet tonight. Let's rise to our feet tonight as we share the grace. We're grateful to be in his house today. Let's give him one more shout before we go. Amen. Amen. Shall we share the grace in fellowship tonight? Okay, before we share the grace, we want to just give that last minute to anyone here. You haven't given your life to Christ, or you want to use this opportunity to rededicate your life to Christ. You want to connect back, especially as we're celebrating his death, his resurrection. Please step forward tonight. If you want to step forward, wherever you are, just lift up your hands as we pray for you. You want to give your life to Christ? Anybody here like that? God bless you, my sister. Lift it up. Let's see. Okay. Okay. Amen. Amen. Just say after me, Father, I confess my sins tonight. I rededicate my life to you tonight. I ask that you forgive me my sins, Almighty God, and that you wash me from all my sins with your blood tonight. Thank you, Father, for accepting me in your kingdom. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. One of our ministers will meet up with you after service, please. Mr. Ken will meet with you after service. Amen. Let's share the grace in fellowship tonight. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore.